Okay, I'm explaining why the new atheists are wrong when they say that Christians believe in fantasies, things they have absolutely no reason to believe are true. I've argued that the existence of the universe, the existence of an objective moral standard, and the existence of free will are reasons to believe in the existence of God. And I'm in the middle of arguing that the origin of life supports the existence of God, and that it's more reasonable to believe that the origin of life requires intelligent design than to believe it does not. And as I said last week, the simplest imaginable single-cell organism would require such an astonishing level of integrated complexity that it's absurd to think it could have arisen by blind, purposeless processes. I inundated you with quotes from scientists acknowledging that after decades of intense research, they remain mystified about how life could have begun by purely natural processes. And a major problem with that idea of a naturalistic origin of life, a major difficulty for all naturalistic origin of life scenarios, is that the simplest imaginable cell would need to be able to manufacture hundreds of different kinds of proteins to be able to accomplish the task necessary for life. And when I was so rudely interrupted by the bell last week, I was trying to explain why that is such a problem. Now, I tried to race through and get it out, so I want to spend a little bit more time on this, and the reason I want to is I want you to really get it and see why it's so crazy. I could just tell you, and you could see these people saying, yeah, it's difficult, we can't do it, don't understand it, seems like a miracle, I want you to see something of why. So then you go, wow. That's why I'm kind of spending time on this. I hope it's not more time than you think is necessary. But I want to go back through this. You recall that there are, so the simplest living cell, theoretically they think we could get it down below 300 proteins would be needed for it to do the task necessary for life. So you remember that there, for each protein, proteins, you recall, this is strings of amino acid, these beads in my necklace idea, and you have 20 of them that are involved in living things and life processes. So you think of it as like 20 letters, like we have an alphabet of 26 letters, and you can arrange them in all kinds of ways. Almost all the ways you can arrange them are gibberish, and they don't mean anything. But there are arrangements that are English sentences, and that's how it is with amino acids, is you string them together in a certain way and you get functioning proteins. So to do that, this simplest imaginable cell, theoretically you could get by with, let's say, 250 proteins. These proteins are these strings of amino acids from, say, 50 to thousands of amino acids together. And so they have to be in the right order, or you get gibberish. It doesn't work. And so we were talking about that, and the arrangement, you say, well, how do they get in the right order? And the arrangement of amino acids, it's determined, if you remember, by the order of nucleotides in the DNA. Now, when I say these things, people go, oh, you know, this is getting, it's really, the way I'm doing it, okay, it's just a simple idea. You've got a string of amino acids, there are 20, like letters in an alphabet, they have to be arranged in the right way to get a protein. You need hundreds of proteins for the simplest living thing. Well, how do they get in the right order? Their order is determined by the order of the nucleotides on the DNA. Remember, there are four kinds, and we're not going to bother with the names of them. Just consider you got four kinds, so they're either a one, a two, a three, or a four in terms of the nucleotides. So how they're arranged on the DNA, that then is the code, the template. So like you'll have 1, 2, 1, 1, 3, 4, 4, 1, 1. And this little machine goes down, and it really is a machine, and it reads the order of the nucleotides, that code, that PIN number. And then it creates this little tape that goes over to another machine, and the machine takes the order that's been created on this tape, recorded, and it reads that, and from that it says, okay, I got a 1, 1, 3 here, so give me amino acid this. I got a 1-4-4 here. Give me amino acid this. And from that, it creates the protein that's needed. Okay, let me give you a little illustration. Here's a little chart I did, or whatever this is, diagram. I don't know what this thing's called. I'm hoping. Let's say we have a string of this is just a very small amino acid, a protein of 48 amino acids. Okay, so we have here, we've got this. This is the protein. These are the amino acids. Each letter is an amino acid. So we have amino acid T, H, I, S, I, S, V. Okay, so it's a very short one. It'd be 48 amino acids. Now, how would the DNA code for that? Well, you look here. Here's the code. So like if you get the sequence of amino acids, I mean of nucleotides on the DNA, 1, 3, 3. Remember, there are only four, so there's either 1 or 2 or 3 or 4. If you get 1, 3, 3, well, that then codes for amino acid A. You got 1, 4, 2, that would be B. 1, 2, 2, that would be E. So to get this string of a protein of 48 amino acids, we would need this pin number. You see, because that would code for amino acid T, H, I, S, I, S, and on and on. So we need a pin number of 144 characters for that. Okay, do you see how it works and how it corresponds? Okay, that's getting at that. That's a pretty. That's just for one small protein of 48 amino acids. We have to have this pin number, and the simplest living thing would need hundreds of proteins, some going to thousands of amino acids. So that's why I said on the DNA you'd have to have a super long necklace that somewhere in it would have the sequence of nucleotides for all of those proteins. So not only here for this one protein that I'm illustrating here, you'd need a sequence on the DNA. You'd need this sequence. But you need the sequence for all the others. And they'd have to be arranged. Now, since the amino acids depend on the arrangement of the nucleotides in the DNA, you see that you have to have, this is a pretty long pin number. I don't know what your pin number is at a bank, but yours is not this long. And that's for one. Okay, that's just for one. Now you say, well, how could the nucleotides in the DNA of the first cell, how could they have been properly arranged to be able to function as a template, the code to manufacture all of the hundreds of proteins necessary for life function in the first simplest cell? How would they get in the right order? You see, if you got to have this one just for one 48 amino acid protein, when you have hundreds of proteins running from 50 to thousands, how would they get in the right order? Well, that's the important thing. I mean, that's the question. The nucleotides, they'd have to be in the right sequence for all those proteins. How did you get such massive pin numbers? How did they get arranged that way? And in answering that, it's crucial to note that the sequence or the order of the nucleotides on the DNA, whether it's 1, 1, 4, 1, 1, 3, however you do it, the order there, it is not determined by chemistry. You see, in terms of chemistry, the number of the nucleotide doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's a nucleotide 1, a 2, a 3, or a 4 in terms of the chemistry. There is no set arrangement. It could be arranged anyway from a chemical standpoint. There's no order, no preference. So that doesn't set the arrangement. Well, how did it get arranged then? How? How did you get all of these massive pin numbers there? Well, chance certainly can't explain the order. I mean, who would think that you could, by chance, hit on this number and that's just one of hundreds? I mean, that'd be pretty long odds, wouldn't it, that you could do that? But chance can't explain it, and nobody thinks that chance can. Here is a quote from the Cambridge-educated philosopher of science, Stephen Meyer. And I'm just doing this to set up why I'm going to look at the probabilities of the amino acid sequence of proteins instead of looking at the probabilities of the nucleotide sequence on the DNA. They're essentially the same. But I want somebody who knows something to verify that for you, so you're not just relying on me in saying it. Here's what Meyer says. The probability that a particular gene, and that's the nucleotide sequence that codes for the protein, Okay. So he says the probability that a particular gene would arise by chance is roughly the same as the probability that its corresponding gene product, that's the protein, okay, the protein that the gene encodes would do so. For that reason, the relevant probability calculation can be made either by analyzing the odds of arranging amino acids into a functional protein, or by analyzing the odds of arranging nucleotide bases into a gene that encodes that protein. So they're essentially the same, roughly the same, close enough. Okay, he says, because it turns out to be simpler to make the calculation using proteins, that's what most origin of life scientists have done. So I want to look at it. If we're going to say, well, maybe you get lucky on these things. Maybe you get all these long pin numbers and it's just, you know, that's just how it is. Maybe you just get lucky doing that. And I want to look at this and say, look, the odds, so I'm going to look at what are the odds of randomly assembling the amino acids from a protein in the right order, understanding that's going to be roughly the same as the odds for assembling the nucleotide bases in the right order on the DNA. That's what Meyer is saying. So most origin of life researchers, because it's a simpler calculation, they just look at what are the odds for arranging the amino acids in the protein. That's why I'm looking at that. And when you look at that, the odds of randomly assembling a particular protein of 100 specific amino acids, okay? My example, I use 48. Most proteins are 50 to thousands of amino acids. But let's take a small protein of 100 amino acids. And the odds of randomly assembling a particular protein of 100 specific amino acids is approximately 1 in 10 to the 130th power. Okay, that's 1 in 1 followed by 130 zeros. Now, this is a big number. You see, this is a big number. And you get that because you multiply probabilities, right? So I've got 20 amino acids in play. Really, there'd be more than that if we restrict it to the 20 that are available or used in living things and proteins. Let's just work with those 20. So what are the odds of getting the right amino acid in slot 1? Well, 1 out of 20. What are the odds of getting the right amino acid in slot 2? Well, that's 1 out of 20. Well, then what are the odds of getting both of them, in the right one in slot 1 and the right one in slot 2? Well, you multiply the probabilities. That's going to be 1 out of 400 because it's 1 out of 20 times 1 out of 20. Then it would be times 1 out of 20 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 all the way out to 100. And that's how you get to such an insane number of 1 in 10 to the 130th. But some slots, I alluded to this last week, see, in some slots, more than one amino acid would work. Okay, mainly they got to be right in the right order, but on some slots, you've got another one would fit in. In other words, if you had a different amino acid, it would still function as a protein. Okay, so that's going to improve the odds, right? So it would be 1 out of 20, say, times 2 out of 20. Times 1 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 2 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 1 out of 2 out of 20. So you're going to improve the odds, but it still leaves you with a breathtaking long shot to get one protein of only 100 amino acids long. In fact, based on the work of the MIT biochemist Robert Sauer and Douglas Axe, who has a doctorate in chemical engineering from Caltech, when you take into account the possible variations in amino acid sequences, the odds of randomly assembling a single functional protein of only 100 amino acids remains considerably smaller than 1 in 10 to the 65th power. Okay? So here it is if you have no variation, 1 in 10 to the 130th. If you do the calculation allowing that for some slots, you could have a different protein in there, then for a small 100 amino acid protein, the odds of allowing it to randomly assemble in the right order is 1 in 10 to the 65th power, and this is conservative. This doesn't take into account that these amino acids, they come in left and right-hand varieties. And only the left-handed one can work. We're ignoring that. But still, you see, this is an insanely large number. You say, well, how insanely large is this number? Because when you just throw out things like this, you know, what's 1 in 10 to the 65th mean to me? I mean, yeah. All right, well, let me tell you how big this number is. It is estimated that there are 1 in 10 to the 65th atoms in our galaxy. 1 in 10 to the 65th atoms in our galaxy. So the odds of randomly assembling a protein of 100 amino acids, granting that some can be different ones, that the order, there's some play in the order, would be like just saying, okay, I'm going to shoot an arrow somewhere in the galaxy and I'm going to hit the right atom. I mean, if I told you the odds are like the atom of a doorknob, you'd say, well, forget it, I'll never make that. Well, we're not talking doorknob, we're not talking person, we're not talking building, city, state, nation, world, we're talking galaxy. All right, so do you see this? That's one. And you have to have hundreds of them that are produced. All right, here's what Stephen Meyer said in 2011. He says, when one considers the full complement of functional biomolecules required to maintain minimal cell function and vitality, one can see why chance-based theories of origin of life have been abandoned. See, everybody can do these calculations. They understand that you cannot randomly assemble these things, and that's not going to work. But they haven't been able to find a mechanism that will get around the odds. That's why when I quoted all those people that say it's still a mystery, we don't get it. We haven't even seen the surface. Because they say, listen, there has to be something that beats random. There has to be some mechanism or process that we can't see that is dictating this, but they can't find one. But they all understand you can't just shake a bag and get these things. That's simply not going to work. Now, you can see that the coding regions of DNA, those nucleotide sequences, you can see that they function much the same way as a computer program. I hope you know, they're very similar to a computer program. They direct operations within a complex material system through long and specific sequences of characters that give precise instructions. That's like, see, computer coding with the ones and zeros. Well, what's going on? Well, there's a sequence of all these characters. It's giving information through the sequence. And that's what you're getting with these nucleotides. They are giving information through the sequence, long and specific sequences that are like computer codes. Here's what Dawkins said about that. The machine code of the gene is uncannily computer-like. Bill Gates, the Microsoft guy, he says human DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created. Here's what Hubert Yockey says. Now, Yockey's a physicist and an information theorist. He wrote this in 2000. He said, it's highly relevant to the origin of life that the genetic code is constructed to confront and solve the problems of communication and recording by the same principles found both in the genetic information system and in modern computer and communication codes. Well, that's just, I don't know anybody that isn't fascinated by that. That here you've got this coding system that's giving information, and it's just like computer stuff. And in every case where the cause of this kind of specified complexity is known, every case where we see specified complexity, not just complexity, not just a long sequence of numbers, but a long sequence of something, see, that matches something of independent significance. Anytime we see specified complexity and know the cause of it, it is always an intelligence. That is the only cause we know that can generate specified complexity. If you went and saw a long string of English letters, alphabet, just a string of letters, and it was just gibberish, you'd look at it and you go, okay, well, that's really complex. I mean, it's a long thing. There was 1 in 26 by 1 in 26 by 1 in 26 by 1 in 26 by 1 in 26. It's really complex to get that, but it's not specified. It doesn't match something of independent significance. Now, if that same length of string of letters spelled out a long English sentence, you would then know that somebody had arranged them. You would say there had to be an intelligence. You would infer intelligent involvement from the fact that this complex string was specified, that it matched something of independent significance. That's what's behind the SETI program. You know that program, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence? It takes for granted. It takes for granted that an intelligence must be behind any radio signal that exhibits specified complexity. That's why in that movie Contact, that movie starring Jodie Foster, that's why in that movie they just freaked out when they received radio signals that were a long sequence of prime numbers. You know, prime numbers being a number greater than one that can be divided evenly only by itself in one. You see, 1, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, on and on and on. So when they got this long sequence of prime numbers, they freaked out because they inferred that only an intelligence could be the source of that. So they had contact. Contact with what? Contact with an intelligence. Why? Because it was specified complexity. The only cause we know of that can create specified complexity is an intelligence. So it seems to me, you know, people say, well, you know, you're just brain dead. You just have no reason. It seems to me that it is more reasonable to infer that an intelligence was involved in producing the specified complexity in DNA. Why is that not reasonable? If the only cause we know, so much so that people in SETI, when they get this long sequence of prime numbers, freak out and they say we've made contact with an intelligence. And I see this in DNA. And I infer from that there's intelligent involvement there. They infer it from there, and they call me a moron. They say, you have no reason for it. What are you talking about? That's a reasonable inference from that. Right? As the renowned philosopher Anthony Flew, he acknowledged in 2004, now Flew spent his entire career arguing for atheism. He was one of the most prominent atheist philosophers of the 20th century. And in 2004, Flew said, the findings of more than 50 years of DNA research have provided materials for a new and enormously powerful argument to design. You see, so Flew recognized it, and Flew, in fact, abandoned his atheism. He recognized the power of it. And so there it sits. Now, before leaving the atheist's origin of life problem, let me point out the mother of all vicious circles. See, proteins, as I've said, they're essential for a living cell, and proteins are produced within the cell according to or from the DNA template, from the order, the sequence of nucleotides. So they're essential, they're produced from the DNA template, but the kicker is that many proteins are necessary to produce proteins from the DNA template. See, proteins are produced from the DNA template, but you have to have proteins in order to produce proteins from the DNA template. So how did it ever get started? How would it get started? You see, it's like you have to have steel before you can make steel. Yeah. Well, how would the whole thing get started? If you got to have steel, like that little machine I was telling you about that comes down and reads the nucleotide sequences, that creates that tape that sends it off to that machine to construct the proteins. It's a protein assembly. You see, so it comes in. So you got to have that. And so how would the process get started? How would you do that? How would you get steel in the first place if you got to have steel to make steel? And that's the conundrum. See, that's the problem. In the 1970s, the famous philosopher of science, Karl Popper, He said, what makes the origin of life and the genetic code a disturbing riddle is this. The code cannot be translated except by using certain products of its translation. This constitutes a really baffling circle, a vicious circle, it seems, for any attempt to form a model or a theory of the genesis of the genetic code. Well, I agree with that. I mean, it is quite a puzzle. The biochemist David Goodsell, he wrote in 1998, this is one of the unanswered riddles of biochemistry. Which came first, proteins or protein synthesis? If proteins are needed to make proteins, how did the whole thing get started? Well, if there's somebody creating them, he creates them. But if they have to arise naturally, we're going to say, we're going to get create these proteins. They just kind of fall together, which we know can't happen. But they fall together. This sequence gets together, and it starts reading it. No, I don't think so. Okay. I don't think so. Robert Shapiro, he died in 2011, but he was professor emeritus of chemistry at NYU. And Shapiro wrote in Scientific American in 2007, he said, DNA replication cannot proceed without the assistance of a number of proteins, members of a family of large molecules that are chemically very different from DNA. See, they're amino acids and DNA's nucleotide bases. It says, the above account brings to mind the old riddle. Which came first, the chicken or the egg? DNA holds the recipe for protein construction, yet that information cannot be retrieved or copied without the assistance of proteins. Which large molecule then appeared first in getting life started? Proteins, the chicken, or DNA, the egg? You see, so this is quite a problem. So I didn't want to leave before I mentioned that. So let me recap here where I am, at least the way I think and what I'm doing. Okay, on God's existence. The existence of the universe implies God's existence. The objective morality requires God's existence. Free will requires God's existence. The origin of life requires intelligent design, which implies God's existence. And then next, what I want to assert is that it's more reasonable to believe that purposeless natural processes are not sufficient to explain the diversity of life on Earth than to believe they are. Purposeless, blind, no goal, just bumping around. Those kinds of processes are not sufficient to explain the diversity of life on Earth. Now, according to the atheistic scenario, after the first cell somehow arose through purely blind, purposeless, naturalistic processes, which they have no idea how that happened, but they continue to insist that it did, and that if you doubt it, that you have a problem. But they have no idea. But however that happened, you see, that after that cell arose, all forms of life on the planet, all forms of life on the planet descended from that first cell by purely natural processes. More specifically, by means of the blind, purposeless processes of random mutation and natural selection. Now, this claim likewise has insurmountable problems. There simply is not enough time under any atheistic scenario for the vast array of proteins and other essential biological products present in those countless life forms to have been generated, let alone integrated into functioning systems without some kind of intelligent input or programming. If you start with this thing, let's spot them that. Okay, even though that's a huge difficulty. But let's say we've got this thing here. Can it really, by random mutations and natural selection, can we really from that generate banana trees and whales and bumblebees and spiders? Yeah. It just all works out. Now, there are problems with this, but this is a subject that is too broad and too complicated to tackle as one little slice of what I'm doing. You see, this would be something we would do a class on. But I want to bring this up to you. But if you're interested in it, I can direct you to the works of some highly trained scientists that who developed the point. Now, certainly, the vast majority of the scientific establishment, the vast majority accepts the naturalistic scenario. They control the game. They have this. The vast majority of them do. And they're not going to allow you in the game. Okay, so I just say that's in fact, but let me just give you a few broadsides from some scientists to help keep you from being intimidated by the fact that the vast majority of the scientific establishment accepts the naturalistic story. 1997, the renowned zoologist, French zoologist Pierre-Paul Grasset, whose knowledge of the living world was described as encyclopedic. Here is what Grasset said. What gambler would be crazy enough to play roulette with random evolution? The probability of dust carried by the wind reproducing Dürer's Melancholia, it's an artwork I'm going to show you in a second, is less infinitesimal than the probability of copy errors in the DNA molecule leading to the formation of the eye. Besides, these errors had no relationship whatsoever with the function that the eye would have to perform. In other words, it's not thinking eye. It's not trying to build an eye. It's just blindly moving around. So let's say it took a step toward the eye, just as likely take a step back. You see, that was a little trick with Dawkins' thing where he had a little illustration of a monkey typing something. But see, Dawkins, he kept every letter. He had a goal in mind. So when the thing randomly got this letter, he kept that letter. But there is no head monkey keeping letters, Richard. You have a goal, and you are the mind that is selecting this thing for a goal you're shooting at. There is no goal. I don't know if you got that, but that's the truth. Okay, let me carry on with this. He says, formation of the eye. Besides, these errors had no relationship whatsoever with the function that the eye would have to perform or was starting to perform. There's no law against daydreaming, but science must not indulge in it. Now, here is Dürer's Melancholia. And you could see, if you hung up flypaper in a dust storm, he's saying it's less infinitesimal that you would get this. I mean, that you would get production of all these life forms from random changes to DNA than you would get this from putting flypaper up in a dust storm. Now, I got to tell you, it looks like a long shot that you're going to get that from... You see? So that was Grasset. Now, the late renowned mathematician, the astrophysicist Sir Fred Hoyle, he was knighted in England for his contribution to science. I think he was at Oxford or Cambridge. I don't remember now which one. But he and his colleague Chandra Wickramasinghe, they concurred in Grasset's assessment. This is what Wickramasinghe wrote in 1984. He said, we found, meaning he and Hoyle, we found that there's just no way it could happen. If you start with a simple microorganism, no matter how it arose on Earth, primordial soup or otherwise, then if you just have that single organizational informational unit, and you said that you copied this sequentially time and again, the question is, does that accumulate enough copying errors, enough mistakes in copying, and do these accumulations of copying errors lead to the diversity of living forms that one sees on Earth? That's the general, usual formulation of the theory of evolution. We looked at this quite systematically, quite carefully in numerical terms. Checking all the numbers, rates of mutation, and so on, we decided that there is no way in which that could even marginally approach the truth. Okay, that's Hoyle and Wickramasinghe. Now, 1999, the biologist E.G. Lee wrote in Trends in Ecology and Evolution, he said, the modern evolutionary synthesis convinced most biologists that natural selection was the only directive influence on adaptive evolution. Today, however, dissatisfaction with the synthesis is widespread, and creationists and anti-Darwinians are multiplying. The central problem with the synthesis is its failure to show or to provide distinct signs that natural selection and random mutations could account for observed levels of adaptation. It's just a pipe dream that you can wind up getting this kind of thing through these blind, purposeless processes. The Berkeley-trained cell biologist Jonathan Wells and the mathematician and philosopher William Dembski, they wrote in 2008, the difficulty here goes beyond merely evolving some new biological structure. The degree of complexity in biological organisms is stunning, far greater than the complexity of gene clusters and the structures they induce. Organisms are organized into a hierarchy of nested systems, each composed of multiple interdependent structures. For an organism to function properly, its structures must fit together or integrate within systems that are themselves structural components of higher level systems. The DNA coding for such systems of structures would require hundreds, if not thousands, of genes. Biological structures never sit in isolation, but always need to be coordinated, working together within larger systems that assist the organism in making a living. The Darwinian mechanism shows no ability to effect, to bring about such coordination. You see, so I'm just giving you some broadsides. When you acknowledge that the vast majority of scientists, the scientific establishment, does in fact endorse the naturalistic scenario, I want to give you some of these ideas or people who are scientists so that you're not so intimidated by that. Here's Michael Behe, who's a biochemist. Behe is a biochemist at Lehigh, and he wrote in 2011, he said, recent evolutionary data at the genetic level on astronomical numbers of organisms and species from widely varying branches of life have shown that any process based on randomness cannot explain the complex, coherent, integrated functions of the cell, such as molecular machinery. Therefore, the evolution of life was not a random process. Now, Paul Nelson has a doctorate in the philosophy of biology from the University of Chicago. And as he's pointed out, animal body plans, they unfold in a sequence of steps from a fertilized egg to the cells of the adult form. So, you know, you start out, right? Itty bitty. Right? You start just really microscopic. And then what happens? There's a plan that unfolds from that fertilized egg to the cells of the adult form. And the earliest steps in that unfolding process, they determine the form that ultimately results. It's like laying the foundation of a building, you see. Laying the foundation, that profoundly shapes the building that is constructed. And that's how it is with this unfolding. The early steps determine the form that ultimately results. So to change the body plan of an organism, to evolve a new body plan, there must be mutations that are expressed very early in the developmental process. Mutations that alter the laying of the foundation, so to speak. So they have to act very early in this unfolding process if you're going to alter the body plan, because the body plan gets shaped early. So you say, okay, so if we're going to change the body plan, if we're going to evolve from body plan A to a distinct body plan B, then we're going to have mutations that work early in the developmental process so that we don't get the foundation laid. Because once the foundation is laid, you can tweak the building, but you can't fundamentally alter it. Okay, so these things have to work early. And of course, these early acting mutations, they have to be viable, meaning they can't kill or damage the organism, so it can't pass the mutations on to the next generation. Okay, well, I see that. What's the problem? Well, the problem is that from an evolutionary perspective, we know from a century of mutation studies in fruit flies that these kinds of mutations, the mutations that act early in the developmental process, they are least likely to be tolerated by the embryo. You see, if they act, the earlier they act, if you mess up the building and the instruction here by sticking in some random change, well, those are least likely to be tolerated by the embryo. They almost always are lethal or harmful. The only exception to that rule is where one of those early mutations causes the loss of a structure. Not the building of a structure, the loss of a pre-existing structure, which in some circumstances can be advantageous. You know, the classic example is like the beetle on an island. Beetle on an island that flies, the wind blows him out in the water. So if he loses his wings, in that context, it's an advantage because he can no longer fly and get blown out. But you see, the evolutionary story can't simply be losing things that exist. It has to be building things that don't exist. And that doesn't happen. The only exception is losing things. All the other times we see early acting mutations, they're lethal or damaging. Well, that seems to be a real problem. You see, and these guys try to get an audience, and they try to, they say these things to people, and they just get blown off. Oh, what do you know? You have religious leanings. You see, that's what they wind up telling them. Now, if you'll go to this website here, www.descentfromdarwin.org, you can download a list of over 900 scientists who signed the statement, "We are skeptical of claims for the ability of random mutation and natural selection to account for the complexity of life. Careful examination of the evidence of Darwinian theory should be encouraged." Now, these are all PhDs in science fields, or they are MDs who also serve as professors at medical schools. One or the other. Okay, so they're all scientists or MDs and professors at medical schools. I heard that, but before I let you go, I wanted to encourage you to go here. I maintain a list here. You can get to this list through my website, but this list has been maintained for years on a True Origin website that another fella manages. But now I think I have 1,328 categorized online articles of interest to creationists. So if you go there, you can read an awful lot about people and arguments and things like that from scientists. Many, many of these people, almost all of them have doctorates in relevant disciplines. Go there and have fun. Thanks.